Yes. So you are able to see the screen, no?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So last class, you know, so we have almost closed our tension members. Okay. So we have seen all the things and how do we calculate all the strengths and other. So tension members, we have only three things. Okay. One is yielding, that is a gross, this one, or rupture, that is, you know, net tensile rupture, and of course the block shear. But in calculating this net tensile rupture, so you have two formulas actually. One is, you know, which can be used directly for all the members. But this formula is very special formula, like one leg is not connected, say. So then outstanding leg, shear lag and other things, you know, comes into picture. So the formula is slightly different, okay, for angle sections. But if both the legs are connected, say, then you should use this formula only. Only one leg only, then only we have, you know, the area is which is not contributing, say. So you have to separate into two types and then, you know, you have to do this design. Then block shear anyway, you know, it is straightforward. So several parts will be there. So you contact. So two formulas have been given, one weak, one strong. You know, so stronger thing tears, the weaker thing yields. Okay. So shear tension, two combinations you use, whichever is the lowest you should use in the design itself. Only problem is you will be having several paths maybe. Okay. So that you have to see it carefully. So this is how the design procedure, you know. So first approximate net area you have to see. Some 25% you increase, you will get the gross area. You also estimate from the gross area formula also, whichever is higher, say. So use it in the, you know, the design. And then, you know, you select a section, you see, from the steel tables hand, that book. And then you do all the checks, whether, you know, bolt connection, whether it is safe or all those criterias. Okay, so these are the steps which we discussed in our last class. So I also showed you how do we do the design, you know, for some two problems, like one is a flat and another one was a angle section. So angle section only problem is, you know, one leg, if it is not connected, then you may have to use the other formula. So this is how we can do. And another last thing you have to verify is the L by R ratio, that is slenderness ratio. So pure tension, I showed you 400, then 350, some numbers have been given. So based on that, you know, you have to select these things itself. So with this, you know, we will close our tension members itself. So before we move to the next unit, say, so this is our checklist actually. Okay, so if you are able to answer this question, that means you are doing fine. Now, what is the answer for the first question? How many modes of failures are there?
Three.
So three modes are there: yielding, net tension rupture, then block shear. Okay. And now, what is the stress strain curve of a tension member with hole? This is a very, very important thing. What happens when there is a hole, you know, in the Coupon test, say. So already you know the stress strain curve for a plate without hole, that is ordinary test. If suppose with a hole, what happens? Nah. How it is going to behave? It is going to be ductile, or how it is behavior, or brittle kind of a thing?
It will be more brittle.
It will be more brittle. Ductility will not. That's why you say that rupture comes into picture. Okay. And now why do we use Fi in the yielding formula? Why not Fu, you know, because steel has extra strength, right? Why we are using Fy?
Serviceability
requirement, okay, because it, you know, it is very, very long. Now, why do we use Fu in the rupture formula? In the rupture, we use Fu, not Fy here. Why? It is related to second question only.
Limit state.
Limit state, more or less that stress strain curve is more or less, you know, like this. There is no ductility followed, right? So we use Fu itself. But what do we do in calculations? We use Fu or 0.9 times Fu.
0.9
times. That is one safety factor, you see, we keep actual, because, you know, we are going to the larger than the rupture itself. Okay. Now, what is shear lag? See, this is a very, very, tell me.
Lag in achievement of shear stress when it is, when there is an unconnected leg.
No, but why we call as a shear? See, this is a tension members. We are discussing tension members. The word is a shear. In tension member, what is shear, right?
The unconnected member is sheared by the connected member.
No, that is, you have to be specific. See, there is no shear anywhere, you followed, right? It is a tension member only. But near the connection, how the loads are getting transferred from one plate to another plate?
Bolt shear.
Bolt shear, okay, that's what you see. So now what you told is correct only. So the tension, say the load is getting transferred as a shear near the bolts, you know, that connection. So the unconnected, as you mentioned, right, unconnected portion, the stresses will be low. Connected portion stresses will be high. So there is a lag actually. That's why you see the shear lag comes. So be careful. So although the tension member, but the shear lag, you know, this work, you know, somehow you follow the bolts and others, you know, it is okay. So this happens only near the connections. But as you move far away from the connection, in the whole member, you will be having tension only. That's what. Now, tell me, what is the sixth one when the hole is punched instead of drilling?
What happened? Area around the hole becomes strain hardening happens there and it will become brittle and it will lose its
capacity. Excellent. So that is a problem of punching. Now, how does our code handles punched holes? What our code says?
Extra radius.
How much it is? Plus?
2 mm.
Okay. How international codes handles? How do we handle international codes? Like British code or Euro code or something I mentioned you. So what do they do? You remember those factors K1, K2, K3, K4. So in that, I think the K2 factor, I think it was related to the K2 or K3. Okay. So one was related to the punch hole. So international people, what do? So they don't increase the hole diameter. What they do is the old thing only they use, but they will multiply by stress reduction factor. Some 0.85 times the area, you know, they decrease actually the international code. So sometimes, you know, so the area as usual, no 2 mm, no extra, same thing only, but you reduce by 0.85. But our IS code does plus 2 mm. Okay. And now the Y diameter has to be increased for the punched hole. So anyway, this is the same, you know, both of them are related because, you know, because the thing reduces, say. That's why you see we do this 2 mm. Now to how do you calculate net angle for net area for angle sections when both the legs are connected? When both are connected, so how do you calculate?
We rotate the section so that it becomes a flat plate.
Excellent. So this is connected. This is it becomes like a plate kind of a thing, and then you use the standard formula, but you will have a new gauge distance actually. Okay, so because you know, so this gauge and this you follow, you have to subtract some thickness here and there. So new gauge distance, and you handle the same way, and the formula is also 0.9, that same formula only you have to use. Okay, and now with one leg connected, say, so now you know, so which formula, your same formula you will use or some other formula? One leg is connected, say, and then
we can use that beta formula.
Other formula you have to use.
Or we can use the area reduction formula for an approximation.
Okay, but for international codes they use, right, a shear lag factor K4 or something they use, but our you followed, no? So you have to use this other formula, that beta, that you have to account for both the areas. Okay, and now how does IS code calculate shear lag? Okay, now how does IS code calculate shear lags? That formula is there. Now that formula came from where?
Sir, shear lag as in, is that 1 minus x bar by L or
is a formula, sir. Very good. But our IS code, what does it do? We don't use 1 minus x bar by L, right?
Number of bolts and K4 factor.
But our IS code, we don't do all those things you followed, right? 1 minus x bar by L we have to use, but our IS code, what does it do? We don't do anything like that. We use, you know, this formula we use, you followed. And then, you know, we use this alpha, that is, you know, the connection length is more, say, some one more, you know, the constant is given in the code itself. Okay, so this is how we calculate our shear lag. Now, but this formula has been developed where? The shear lag formula, that beta and others?
IIT Madras.
That you should understand. Okay, the shear lag formula, it came from our laboratory only, structures lab only. Okay, so one MS student, you know, they done lot of work and that formula, say, we went into the IS codes. Okay, so some of you also, you know, if you do something rigorously, say, so we can even you know, develop some formulas, and if it works nicely, so obviously code also will take care. Okay, so this one thing. Now what is block shear? So of course,
combined failure of tensile and shear plane. in which one is weaker section and one is stronger section.
Excellent. So you have given a complete answer. How many planes are there? So obviously, you know, you told already, shear and tensile, two planes are there. Okay. Now, why there are two formulas for block shear?
We have to check which is weaker and which is stronger.
So that you don't know. Followed. Excellent. So you don't know before, right? So we do all those calculations. Now, what is the slenderness ratio of pure tension? What is the limit?
400.
400 is the limit. But if it is, you know, stress reversal happens, then you have a problem. 180 or some other things will happen. Okay. So these are some of the brief questions I've told you. So if you are able to answer all these things, that means you are doing fine and, you know, you can proceed further. So if you have any problem with these questions, say, you can go through the videos. I already have explained. The slides also are there. So see that, you know, you should be able to understand these questions. Okay. So with this, you know, we will close our tension members. So we will go to our next thing, that is, you know, the compression members. Okay. So now the next unit, say, that is the compression. So generally, you know, in our steel design, the easiest thing to design is the tension member, because there is only one design variable, that is simply the area, that's all. So area, you know, means you know everything about the tension member. Okay. So the next thing, say, the complexity increases, that is, you see the compression members. So, you know, it is a little bit complex, you know, compared to, you know, this one. So now compression member, the definition is like this. Okay. So structural members, which is straight. Okay. No eccentricity, no geometrical imperfections, perfect straight. Okay. And it is subjected to a compressive force. Okay. Acting along its centroidal axis, say. So this we call as a compression member. So this is the definition of a compression member. So compression member means the member has to be straight. No, the member, you know, there is no small imperfection should not be there. And the load also should act exactly at the centroid, say. So this we call as, you see, the pure compression, or, you know, the compression member. Okay. But what happens in practice? Now, do you have anything like that? So you are staying in multi-story buildings, right? So do you have any column, you know, which is a pure compression? No. Do you have like this, a pure compression kind of a thing? See, in multi-story buildings, if you take, say, so what happens? You will be having columns, you know. So these columns will be subjected to what type of loads? So if I see this column, okay, so it will be pure compression, or what will happen here? So at this junction between beam and column or whatever thing, so what happens?
Bending moment.
So bending moment will be there, you know, sometime you follow, right? Shear, this compression. So all kinds of complexities will be there, you know, in reality. And, you know, it is not, so you see, the load will never act at the centroid of the column. You followed, right? If you see in the buildings, you know, so it will not be perfect, you know, UDR or something, you say some small eccentricities will be there, you know, and the columns also, when you do in practice, they may not be perfect straight also, you know, some small, you know, crookedness, maybe there's some small column, you may be followed, right? Something like this, or some small bent also will be there actually. Okay. So in the columns, so this also may happen, geometrical imperfections and other things, you know, so many issues are there. So generally, so when there is a, you know, where, so the members, where influence of compression predominates over that of a movement actually. Okay. So this also, you know, although you may be having bending moment and all other things, you followed it, but if the compression load is the main dominating, say, of course, you know, compression member definition is this one, pure actually, okay, only compression. But in reality, you doesn't have anything like a compression. You have bending moment or other kind of torsion or something else also may be there. But compression is more also, then also we call it as a compression member only. So in buildings, if you see columns, you know, although they will have bending moment and other things will be there, but still we call them as a compression member, because, you know, the compression dominates the other two, you know, other things actually, like bending moment, torque and other things also compression member. Suppose, you know, if the bending moment, the bending stresses are also, you know, comparable, say, with the compressive stress, or the torsion, say, is also compared with that one or something, so then we call as a beam column. So in your mechanics also, there are two things, are the compression member, then beam column. So beam column, me, both are same only, But beam column means, you know, you have movements and other things comes into picture, say, you know, and they're comparable with the compression. So then we call as a beam column. So the words, you know, we use carefully, beam column, compression member kind of a thing. And not only that one. So, you know, some people columns say they also call as a strut actually. Tension members, what do they call? I showed you right in the starting slide. So tension members, they're also known as, nah, what is the other name?
Ties.
When they're used in the ties, in the trusses. So compression members say, when they're used in trusses, okay, so we call them as, you know, strut. So this is a word, tri and strut model, you know, like that also people talk. Strut means compression, tri means tension. Of course, in buildings and others, you know, we call them as columns or stanchions, you know, so these words are used actually, okay. So strut is also same, stanchion or column is also same. But if bending moment, other things are also equally dominating, say, then you know, you have to analyze that as a beam column. We will see all those details. So now you know, tension member is very, very easy actually. Only criteria was simply the area was there. But in columns, what is the extra thing you have to do? What is another main issue in the columns?
Buckling.
Buckling. So it can buckle in because the columns are in 3D, no? It can buckle in any direction, X direction, Y direction, or along its principal axis, say. That also may happen actually, okay? So for columns, you know, what happens is it's not only just the yielding or something you have to worry, you also have to worry about buckling. So there are local buckling is there, global buckling is there, so many, you know, issues comes into picture. So generally for compression members, you may have to do extra, you know, some additional checks you have to do, okay, for buckling, you know, how it have to handle, not only just the area, so you have to handle this buckling also, okay. So this becomes very, very important. And buckling is related to what parameter controls buckling, which one, area or section modulus, or what is that you essentially look for in buckling, the important design parameter?
Slenderness ratio.
Slenderness ratio, but slenderness ratio is some lambda, if you write L by R kind of a thing. So what is R here? So L anyway you can't control, okay? So L is decided, the length of the column, you know, that is decided already, like 10 story building or 3 story building, you know, L is decided, but R is in your hand actually. What is R?
Radius of gyration.
Radius of gyration. So our radius of gyration means it is linked to anyway moment of inertia, AR square or something you followed, no? So moment of inertia also comes into picture. So whenever you are having a compression member, say, it is not only simply the area of the member, but moment of inertia or anyway the radius of gyration, say. So they play, you know, very, very important role itself. So if you are having a, so you are having like in steel, no, that you know, that steel tables, you have several options, angle section, equal, you know, channel sections or whatever. Generally when you, you know, see this all these things, say, so generally for buckling, you know, these columns, so if we section, ideal section, say, is the one which has same moment of inertia about any of the axis through its center of gravity. This is the one which is, you know, widely preferred itself. So these are some of the members which are used as, you know, the compression members in our structures. So these things, angle sections, you know, these are very popular. So they are all used in the trusses, okay? So in trusses, you know, the strut models, strut tie you followed, you know, these the things are widely used in, you know, this one itself. Now, what's the problem of these angle sections? Now, as if you use as a compression, what's the problem? Now, what is the problem with the angle sections? Now, see, now we were looking only at area, and now you also have to look at, now, what is extra thing you have to look for when you're designing these? Now,
moment of inertia.
Moment of inertia, anyway, moment of inertia or radius of gyration also you can say. And but the moment of inertia also, this type of sections say, so they will have different moment of inertia in x direction something, in y direction something, because these are all asymmetric, no? And you can have a principal axis also, so many complications will be there actually, okay? So all those things comes into picture. So now you can see this type of a form, so this is a cruciform, they say, you followed, right? So this type of a structure, you know, you can have equal moment of inertia, you know, in both the directions also. So sometimes, you know, people use this type of structures also, or, you know, something like this, you know, as a compression member, or, you know, as both the angles, they are joined to one side, or, you know, like this also people use, and channel sections, say. So these are also widely used in, you know, this our compression member. But the for compressions, which is the best member? Which is the best if you want to use as a compression among all these sections which I'm showing here, which is the best? So criteria is area, then radius of gyration also. It should be same in all the directions. Then it is very easy to calculate. Okay, which is the best?
730.
Which one?
730.
No, southern, but I'm not able to understand.
Seventh figure
means this one you are saying.
Yes, sir.
This is the one. So now, but which will have equal moment of inertia in all the directions? See, suppose if I take a direction you followed, right, it should be isotropic kind of a thing. Which one circular. Has the equal circular only? So circle you followed, right? Anything you take, answer is everything is round only, right? So circular sections are the widely, you know, preferred. And another advantage of circular is these hollow circular sections, say. Okay, this is also good only, this is also fine, but you have other issues are there. So hollow circular sections, if you see, say, okay. So these are the ones which are, you know, the tubular columns or something. So they are the widely, you know, more preferred actually as a compression member. Okay. But anyway, in practice, you see, we use even I sections also as a columns followed, right, when heavy loads have to be carried, or built up sections, or these type of columns, so lacing column, battens columns, we will see later on. Okay. Lacing, battens, you followed it. This also we use actually. Okay. So like, so what I'm trying to say is, so apart from areas, radius of gyration also, you have to look for something extra, okay, in the steel tables when you want to design a compression member. So now another most important thing in compression member is, you remember this classification, even in the assignment, I think quiz also we asked, plastic section, compact section, semi-compact section, slender section, we have discussed all those things. In tension members, this was not required actually, okay. So you could have used the area was the only criteria, it is done. But in compression member, what's the problem you are having? You should always avoid? No. So which type of sections you have to use? Plastic, compact, semi-compact, then we have slender also, the class 4, you remember. So now what is the most important thing you have to do?
Avoid slender sections.
Avoid slender, so you know, you remember that's a classification was there. If you have a slender section, so you know, you have to check whatever thing you are using, say angle sections essentially. If I am using this or this or this, you have to do this section class. If it is a tension member, no need to check this one easily, you know, we are not worried about this at all. But if you are designing a compression member, so plastic, semi-compact, this becomes very, very important, and you should always avoid the slender cross sections. Okay, because in the steel tables, they have some sections are there. So they may be slender. So if it is a slender section, what you will do to make it semi-compact? So what you will do? I explained you in the, you know, the long lecture. So if this has come as a slender section, now how do I convert into a semi-compact or a compact section?
Join two sections.
The join, that is one thing. No, I don't have option to join. I have only angle only. So this, if I want to convert into other class, what is that you have to do?
Increase the number of members.
No member. I have only one member. I have only one angle section, some 75 by 75 by 6 or something. It has turned out to be slender, that D by T or H by TW or whatever. What is that you have to do to make it into semi-compact?
Reduce its strength.
Add more material to.
No material, you can't add anything, you followed, right? So what did we do, you remember long back we said,
reduce.
So
reduce it,
so reduce the you know, the D by T or H by T or some, so you remember we reduced this, you followed, right? These things, so you cut effective areas, say. So we are not, although for you know, you take as you do, you don't cut anything or something like that, but the usable area you followed, right? You take it and then, you know, you design, you remember. So this we discussed long back. Okay, so you can make a slender section to semi-compact also. So you have to decrease D, so D by T. So thickness, you can't do anything because it is a governed. So D, usable D, I should say. You are not going to cut anything. So the usable D, so if D is 75, say, you assume in your all design calculations as 70 itself, actually, such that, you know, it will be more than this 15.7 times epsilon or something. That is how we do. So the section classification becomes very, very important for, you know, this type of compression members. And this is the first check you have to do. You can't do whatever you like, okay? So you have to check this, and slender things should not at all be used in compression members. If you want to use, then this is the one you have to do, like, you know, decrease the area or effective area or something you have to do, okay? And now this is also one same slenderness ratios, okay? I showed you for tension, same thing values here also. So if a member compressive forces, say, so its slenderness is, you know, 180. So this is how, you know, it is limited to, okay? Of course, you know, secondary members are, you know, these type of members, a compression only from earthquake or wind only if it is subjected, then 250. See, compression flange of a beam, say, then it is a 300. So these are the guidelines, you see, given in the, you know, the code. This is also same thing we also use in tension also, but these are some of the guidelines. So the primary member, so now the columns, you are staying in your home, right? The multi-story buildings, if it is a steel building, so it should, slenderness ratio should be less than which one you have to take? So in multi-story steel buildings, what should be the slenderness ratio? Which is the guideline here? 180, 250, 300, or which one you will use?
180
is the guideline, because dead load, live load, right? All your buildings, okay? So the 180 is the guideline, okay? So these are what some, you have to verify this also. This also is extra, you know, of course, intention also we did this one, but here this becomes very, very, you know, the important thing, okay? And now there are, you know, buckling, you know, several types of, I say, modes are there here also, like flexural buckling, we say, which you have studied in your mechanics of material also, okay? So deflection about the axis, say, having, like, you see, if I have a column like this, you see, so it buckles like this. In 3D, the column can buckle along X direction, Y direction, or Z direction, or any other direction it can buckle. So it will buckle in a direction where, you know, your radius of gyration is small itself, okay? That is how, you know, it buckles. So this is what we call as, you know, the Euler buckling, which you people have studied in your mechanics of materials. Then there is one more thing, what we call as, you see, torsional buckling. So thin-walled members, say, with open cross-section, essentially that cruciform I showed you, right, this type of a shape. Although flexural buckling, it may be fine, but it buckles in torsion, okay? So this also is a headache, actually. So generally, you know, your flexural buckling, say, it depends on, you remember that Euler's formula, no, pi square, you know, EI by, you see, L square kind of a thing. So EI, that is a flexural rigidity. So your buckling, flexural buckling, say, it depends on EI, actually. Now, torsional buckling, say, it depends on GJ, that is, you know, rigidity, shear rigidity or whatever. So, if I have a torsional rigidity, GJ, you follow, if it is, you know, less than, you see, EI, say, so then, you know, it buckles in torsional mode, okay? So, if it EI is smaller than GJ, say, then it becomes in an ordinary, that flexural buckling mode itself. So, this also, you have torsional buckling also is there. Then another thing is a flexural torsional buckling. You can have a combination also of flexure plus torsion. So sometimes, you know, we also call this as lateral torsional buckling. So many words are there, okay? So this type of buckling you will see in unsymmetrical cross sections, okay? Like a channel sections, structural T's, double angles, and all those things is unequal angles, you know? So this also, you know, we see them in practice, okay? We will see all those things, you know? So there are basically three types, you know, we say. Now, another thing, when you do a beam set, so then, you know, this is what we call as a lateral torsional buckling also. Okay, so several modes are possible. You followed. So this also happens, actually. And we will discuss this LTB, that is lateral torsion buckling, when we come to beams itself. Okay. So now, you know, so let us see what you have studied in your mechanics of materials. We will see the flexural buckling first, which you have already studied. And most of the columns, say, whatever you see in multi-story buildings or whatever, if it is a steel one, the flexural buckling is the most important guideline, actually. Okay. So now, you know, what is the flexural buckling? So now the first thing is, why column buckles? What is the reason? You have studied in mechanics, okay? Why it buckles?
Because its axial movement is restricted, so the only direction in which it can move is in the lateral direction.
Axial thing is restricted. Why it is restricted, right? See, generally our understanding is if I have any bar, say, okay, if it is subjected to compression, this load axial, so what type of deformation should be, this is what type of load, it is axial load only. You followed, it is axial load only. Now when you are applying axial load, say, so deformation also should be axial deformation only, and the length of the member should decrease, you know, after once you apply the load, say, so it should deflect like this. You followed? So Poisson's ratio and other things if you take, so slightly it should reduce its length actually. So this is what should happen. But what is happening here? Now, instead of reducing its length, the column is, into that. The column has to reduce the length. Instead of reducing, it is buckling actually. Why? Why it should buckle?
Sir, when there is a slight eccentricity which we cannot avoid, and the column has much larger sensitivity to bending, as in very low bending strength.
No eccentricity. So you started with the assumption of eccentricity. I am saying no eccentricity. The column is perfect straight. Load is acting at the centroid only. Why it is happening? Why it should happen?
Maybe there is a slight wind load that can push into the buckled mode.
No wind load. No, the column is perfectly straight. Load is also exactly acting at the centroid. Why it has to buckle? See, other person, I think one more person he told, right? Some axial deformation you are restricting or something. You tell me from mechanics point of view, why it has to buckle? When you are applying the load, the column, the duty of the column is it should reduce its length, that's all. You followed, right? But instead of reducing the length, it is buckling in other way around actually. Why it is happening, that's all.
Sir, once it has buckled by a very small distance, then a component of force is generated which acts in the horizontal direction and will cause bending.
No. What I'm asking is why it has to buckle. There is no eccentricity. There is no nothing is there. Why it should go in other way direction? See, if I'm applying the load like this, okay, deflection also should be in the same direction, right? But here the problem is you are applying the load in X direction, but deflection is happening in other direction actually. Why?
Sir, see, you are applying... the column is more, and the column is by buckling trying to regain its original length.
Trying to regain its original length. I think not. You have to refine your definition. Please give me mechanics point of view. You followed, right? Pure mechanics. Or I will give you a clue also. Energy you can use. Based on energy, can you tell me anything? I have given you clue based on energy. Anything can you comment? You know, right, that principle of what is it, minimum energy, you remember it, complementary potential energy, and so many things are there. No. See, I have given you a clue also, energy. See, in nature, say, like you had studied it, projectile or whatever, you know, the path or something, say, and nature chooses which path generally. See, if I have two paths, stable is different. Suppose you have two paths are there, okay, which path nature chooses always? See, it is like you only, if you want to come to department from hostel, say, there are several paths are there, right? So which path you will choose?
Path of least resistance.
Least
resistance or least energy?
Least energy. Excellent. Okay. So that is what. So the minimum energy or minimum potential energy or something. So same thing happens in nature also. So now you can mathematically show also. So now for the column, say, it has to reduce its length actually. Okay. So now when you apply one way is it can reduce, it can shorten its length. Okay. That is one way. So the column length is, like this. So it has to shorten its length actually. Okay. So this much it has to shorten the length. Other way is to shorten this much length, the column, what it can do is it can bend like this also, and it can shorten the length also. Okay, so if you calculate energy axial shortening, say that p square by a e, that integrals, structure analysis also you would have seen, and the energy required to bend, so the column it bends, and then for the bending, so what is energy, how much energy is required, say, so the energy for this will be lower than energy for this the axial shortening, actually you followed. So the bending energy, that m square, you remember all those things, by EI integral 0 to L, you have to do those things. So the energy for bending will be smaller than this axial shortening. Okay, so that is the reason you see why column will buckle. So now it is not that all columns will buckle. Now short column, what happens? So short column also two options are there. It can bend and reduce the length, or axial thing is possible. But if you calculate energy this and energy this one, say for this short column, you see energy, the axial shortening will be smaller than bending, actually. So that's why it fails in yielding. Whereas a long column, say, it buckles in, it buckles basically. Okay, so mechanics, so what you have to do is you have to calculate energies. It is same like nature, minimum energy or whatever you followed. No? So same principle is applicable for columns also. So this is why columns buckle. No eccentricity, although the column may be perfect straight, load is acting perfect, this one, everything is perfect, say, but still it buckles actually. And the buckling is a very, very interesting phenomenon, because, load is applied in this direction and it is moving in other direction, actually perpendicular. So generally in mechanics, whenever you apply a load in x direction, say deflection also should be in x direction, but this you followed, right? It happens actually. Okay, so anyway, so here I'm just showing you the the plot also. So this is a a tension member or a very short column, say. Okay, so when you see a very short column, and if you apply a compressive load, the stress strain curve, the load versus the change in length, if you plot, it becomes, the graph is, like this, actually. It fails during yielding, A times F of Y, then you will have a strain hardening or whatever. Anyway, that is not important for us. So this happens for a short column. So there is one technical term also we use in textbook, squash load, actually. S-Q-U-A-S-H, squash load. Okay. So this load, say, which is A times F of Y, is known as a squash load. This is a technical term which is used in many textbooks and even in the courts also. Okay, so this is squash load. Basically, when you are having a short column, say, so you have this type of squash loads. But if it is a long column, say, so then what happens is the column, it will go up to some extent, then, it's just a load versus deformation curve. It behaves like this, actually, because, the buckling starts, and then this, although they may be of same material, FY may be same, but still, because of the the long slender compression or something, energy in buckling is smaller than energy in axial shortening, so the column gives up, and it just buckles at very, very, you followed, right, the low load. The squash load is the upper limit. Okay, so this buckles, and then you see it automatically it comes down. Okay, so this is how the stress strain curve looks like. Now, all of you know this equilibrium. What is equilibrium? Now, what is the simple meaning of equilibrium? Generally, what is equilibrium?
State of lowest energy.
Strength of?
State of lowest energy.
State of low. Okay. We are fine giving that definition. But generally, equilibrium means left hand side should be same as right hand side. Actually, that is the simplest definition we can give. Okay. Now, when you are discussing columns, say equilibrium should be the left hand side, right hand side should be same. But apart from that, there should be one more equilibrium you should call. What is that? One more word you have to add to this equilibrium. Now, what you have to add?
Stable equilibrium.
Excellent. Stable equilibrium. This is what we say. Essentially, stable word has to be added. Here, what is equilibrium state? You already studied in mechanics. What type of this ball? So, three cases, all of them are in equilibrium only. You followed. They are all are in equilibrium. But the first one is in which equilibrium?
Neutral equilibrium.
Neutral, all of you know. The second one?
Unstable.
The last one is? Stable equilibrium. Okay. So you would have studied in mechanics. I will not go into detail. So you can take energy, and if you take its derivative, so derivative of energy will tell you whether it is unstable or stable itself. Zero state will not tell you, you know, this, sorry, this V doesn't tell you the, it gives you only equilibrium, but the derivative will tell you neutral or unstable or stable equilibrium also. So this is also very important word you should know in the columns. Okay. Now, so when you lose, so for also mathematically, so what happens when you are having a column and subjected to this compressive load, say, okay, so this type of load. So what happens in practice is, as you, when the load is very small, say, so the column will be in stable equilibrium actual, okay, so the deflection will be zero only. This deflection means this deflection I'm talking about, okay, that is a perpendicular deflection, not shortening. So what happens is, you know, when the load is very small, delta will be zero kind of a thing. It happens once P approaches a PCR, say, this critical the load or something, then the column which was in stable equilibrium, say, it comes to neutral equilibrium basically. So neutral equilibrium it comes, and if you slightly increase the load by some small unit, you know, that's it, it gives up, and you know, the deflection goes to infinity. That is how our Euler buckling, that equation and other things, you know, have derived in the in mechanics of materials. Okay, so during P is equal to PCR, say, so the column is basically in neutral equilibrium. So it is not like, you know, stable means long columns will be in stable, short columns will be like this, or sir, long column is in unstable, short column is stable, nothing like that. It depends on the load also. Load is small, long column also will be in stable equilibrium only. But when it approaches some load, then, you know, the column will pass through all these three states itself. So P is equal to PCR is like a bifurcation, or, you know, the point where, you know, it can go this way or this way, and then you see unstable happens and it collapses. Okay, so this you have to understand. So now this is the classical, you know, the Euler buckling. Already I think all of you would have, you know, done in your mechanics, Euler's buckling derivation. Maybe in notation, maybe you would have taken P or something like that, you know. So, you know, you take a straight column. So these are what assumption. No eccentricity, the member is absolutely straight, and metal behavior is elastic. No inelastic, no yielding, nothing happens also. You all of you know, right? You can do fourth order ODE, or you can solve in second order ODE also. That is M is equal to EI, D square Y by DX square. And then, you know, you write bending moment as, you know, N times Y. So if this is, if I take any section, say, if it is a W here, so what to do is, of course, D square W by DX square, if you write. So you write bending moment as, you know, N times W, and then, you know, you solve. Or you can write in terms of, if you differentiate two times, say, then you can write in terms of the load also. Okay, so this is a fourth order ODE, or you can solve this also. That is N times W plus, you know, E times I, D square W by DX square, second order ODE. And if you differentiate two times, you will get a fourth order. Both of them will give you the same answer. Okay, so fourth order ODE is, say, so this is my deflection. All of you know how to solve ordinary differential equations. So four constants will be there basically. Okay, so you know the four constants, four boundary conditions. So we use, right, deflection is zero at both the ends for simply supported. Okay, then if it is a simply supported column, say, bending moments are also zero. So four constants, four unknowns are there. So you substitute, and then you know, you find out. So all of them become zero except this, you know, that A1P rho square by sine PL. So this double, when you apply this boundary condition, so is equal to zero. The only way is sine PL has to be zero. Otherwise, A1 also will be zero. So if A1 is zero, say, A2 is there, A3 is there, A4, all of them are zeros only. If all of them are zeros, the column is perfectly straight. It is not even buckling also. For the column to buckle, say, so we have to look for non-trivial solutions. So this non-trivial solution, you see, is given by, you know, this equation, sine PL is equal to zero. Okay, so where this rho is nothing but, you know, L into root of N by EI. It is just a constant, you know, this one. And sometimes in some textbooks, they call this as a strut index also. Some technical, you know, the word like squash load, say. So we have a squash load, so strut index, which is N is the load, EI is the flexural rigidity, you take a square root, multiply by L, so this we call as the strut index also, okay. And finally, when sine PL is zero, say, it has to be I pi by L, and this is our critical buckling load itself. So there are several modes are possible. The first mode, you would have done. Second mode means, you know, one node will be there. Then third mode, say two nodes will be there, one node here, then, you know, the fourth mode, say. So so many solutions you will get. And now you will take which solution among all the buckling modes, say. You will take which one
is equal to
one? I is equal to one. Okay, so finally our answer is pi square EI by L square. So this is how, you know, the Euler's buckling load is comes into picture also. Okay, now another most interesting thing in mathematically interesting thing in buckling is, one interesting thing I told you, one is, you know, load is in x direction but deflection is other direction. Okay, that is one peculiarity with buckling. Now another interesting thing is, generally if it is a linear problem, say how many solutions you have, if it is a linear problem like a straight line, y is equal to mx plus c, say how many roots it has? So linear problem means how many solutions you will be having? There is only one solution only. Okay, but in buckling is also linear problem, but how many solutions we are having?
There are many modes, more than
many. See, one modes, so many solutions are there. But so generally linear problem means, you know, one solution should be there. But buckling is a special kind of a thing. Of course, eigenvalue, that is a different issue. But, you know, you can have, you know, multiple solutions are possible. Mathematically, I'm talking. But physically, no column will buckle like this, actually. Okay, because the load is more and the column would have already gone also. But physically, it is not possible. But mathematically, this is a very interesting phenomenon of the buckling load. Okay, so this is how the pi square EI by L square comes into picture, which all of you know, you would have studied in your mechanics of materials. But the problem with the Euler's buckling load is, you know, all these things have been removed. That is eccentricity, then absolutely straight and, you know, elastic. So these are all the assumptions. And then, you know, you also would have done by changing the support conditions, actually. So simply supported, simply say. So C means, you know, fixed, actually. So this is one end is fixed, other end is simply supported. So when the support conditions are different, what you have to do? Same solution is valid only. But, you know, your boundary conditions will be different. Suppose if it is a fixed, say, what are the boundary conditions? This is valid for simply supported. If it is a fixed, what will be the boundary conditions? If the both the ends are fixed, what is the boundary condition?
Zero slope at both ends.
So W is zero. So instead of W dash, double dash, say, you have to use W dash of zero like this. So you solve, once again, you will get a buckling load. If it is one end is simply supported, another end is fixed, say, then, you know, you have to do like W dash is zero at one side, W dash is zero at other place. Suppose if it is a cantilever, say, so then one side deflection slope are zero, other side, what's the boundary condition for a cantilever? So this is zero and this is L. What are the boundary conditions? So x is equal to L, what is zero?
Slope is zero at one point, deflection is unconstrained at other point.
No, but how do you write the boundary conditions for cantilever? Cantilever, what's the boundary condition at the free end? This end, what's the boundary condition? Here it is a fixed, so W is zero, then a W dash, slope is also zero at the fixed end. And now at the free end?
Moment and shear are zero.
Moment and shear. So moment is related to which derivative? See, first derivative is, say, W is deflection. W dash is slope. And moment is which derivative?
Second derivative.
W dash. And what else is zero? Moment is zero. Shear also. Shear means which derivative?
Third derivative.
Third derivative will be zero. So like that, you know, you have to apply the boundary conditions and you can calculate all the buckling loads also. But generally in mechanics, what we do is, we don't do right like this. We write in a general formula kind of, I think, pi square EI by, of course, some textbooks use beta, some textbooks use KL also. Okay. So where this KL, say, what do we call this KL? In mechanics, what did you call that one? Other course. You call this as? what do we call this? Effective length of a column, actually. Okay, so like this, you know, you use a LE or something. So these are the terms. So simply supported, say effective length is L only. Okay, and now if it is one end is fixed, other end is simply supported. So effective length is 0.7, then both the ends are fixed, say it is a 0.5. For cantilever it is 2, and sway or something if it is 1 itself. So you can also interpret this effective length as, you know, this is a buckling mode shape for a fixed column. So for fixed, say, because at the ends slope and deflection are zero, so this is how the column buckles actually. So these are the points of this, the inflection actually. So these two, the length between this also is nothing but, you see, the effective length. And anyway, you see, that becomes L by 2 or something, you know, you will get these numbers. So now this is fixed at this end, and this is hinged actually, simply supported at this end. So here a hinge is there. So, you know, this is my length, L by root 2, that is a 0.7 you will get. Now, if it is a cantilever, say, so you have like this, and this is 2 times here, the effective length also. Yeah, you have studied in mechanics of materials also. Okay. So now, you know, our code also gives you, these are the, you know, our code also gives a table actually to find out effective length for various boundary conditions. These are the theoretical values, 0.5, 0.7, 1, 1, you followed it, 2 and 2. But our code, you know, to be on the safe side, say, it recommends, say, you know, 0.65, you can see. So these values are, because we don't know, you know, in practice, you see, there is nothing like a fixed connection. See, beam and column, say, that you cannot have anything like, you know, 100% fixed or 100% hinged or something, you know, it is not allowed actually, okay? So this doesn't work in practice. You don't have like, you know, bending moment is perfectly zero or deflection is perfectly zero. So the code recommends slightly, you know, the different values actually compared to the theoretical value. Theoretical value comes from the classical derivation. So these numbers are slightly, you know, the different itself. Okay. So anyway, so time is over. So I will stop here. So we will continue in our next class. Okay. So if you have any questions, you can ask.